This is a lecture on the Pioneer Plus catheter, and this is going to be my experience with this over the last several years. So our objectives today are going to be four. We're going to discuss total occlusion crossings by subintimal angioplasty or the PIER approach. We're going to discuss radiation issues with lengthy CTO cases. We're going to discuss the Pioneer catheter and include problem-solving issues as well as tips and tricks of the device that I've learned over the years. And we're also going to have a few case examples so you can see this. First off, the PIER approach, which is essentially subadventitial angioplasty. We know this has a poor patency rate over years as the anatomical area is not the vessel, it's actually in the subadventitial. We have multiple problems as the location, torsion forces, repetitive flexion. So all these things will aggravate restenosis. So what's so important about central lumen crossing? Certainly, it keeps the crossing as clean as possible because it lies within the anatomical portion, not in the subadventitial area. By deflecting into the media or the adventitial space, there are several anatomic distortions that are inherent, and this comes at certainly a cost on vessel patency, including the activation of certain cellular components in the subadventitial space that promotes tissue growth and restenosis. Vessel perforations, dissections, loss of collaterals, and certainly the lesion treatment extension are inherent manifestations of adventitial crossing in all CTOs. And these vessel injury patterns that we're talking about certainly can accelerate vessel healing in the adventitial, turning on cellular milieu that can cause restenosis. Angiography is sort of the mainstay of what we've all been trained on for doing angiography and interventions. But what are the limitations? You certainly can't appreciate vessel walls. You can't appreciate it's a two-dimensional object that you're seeing, for which is a three-dimensional vessel. So it certainly, without multiple views, it becomes very difficult to ascertain the severity of disease. It masks the tortuosity. Certainly when the leg is bent, you can see that what the SFA looks like. And when it's in a straight portion, you can see it looks just like a straight line. And exposure to radiation is a significant problem for both the patient and the physician. So this is a comparison of the imaging modality. You can see the fluoroscopy, which is really a two-dimensional view. What in-plane IVUS gives us not only the picture of the absolute vessel, but what it does is it gives us all these perivascular structures as well. So when we rapidly enter the distal target vessel, that will certainly reduce radiation complication rates. And the distance between the false lumen of a PIER crossing, which is the subadventitial crossing, and the true distal reference lumen can be considerable, sometimes as many as 5 to 10 centimeters. And these can go into areas that are non-desirable, such as popliteal regions. Conventional wire entry may not be feasible as many cases as 10 to 20% are not crossable because of poor reentry. And this also can increase the procedural and fluoro times during this attempt. Average fluoroscopy times for crossing in the literature has ranged up to 20 minutes. So why is radiation a problem? Well, there are multiple health risks to not only the physician and the patient, but others in the room. There have been multiple reports on things such as brain tumors, and left-sided brain tumors, which is the side that the radiation exposure is the greatest to for all interventionalists.
And if you look at radiation exposure on peripheral vascular procedures, it's much more significant than even coronaries. If you look at the dose ranges for the pelvis, the thigh, below the knee, all these will take significant amounts of fluoroscopy, and certainly as we're doing much more below the knee work for critical limb, the mean radiation exposure time is much more significant. So the Pioneer Plus catheter, which has been around for a while as a technology, we've used it for many different modalities now, more than just reentry. It's considered a bailout reentry device initially, and it's been used for the pure technique to get into the distal vessel after crossing has failed. This is an example of the movie of a subadventitial area. The vessel's rotating, and now it's at 12 o'clock, as you can see. And how we do this is we rotate the catheter till the vessel is in the 12 o'clock position. Then the knee can be the needle can be punctured into the open vessel, thus re-entering the vessel beyond the point of actual exit point. This is the Pioneer Plus catheter. You can see starting from the right, it's a over the it's a monorail system. The port in the back is where the wire goes into the needle. You have the handle. The blue knob is the needle deployment with an auto lock ring, so you can lock it so the needle does not puncture at times that you don't want it to. There is a needle stop ring with a lock, and it has the depth markers at 3, 5, and 7 millimeters, so you can turn that knob to the depth that you want and then advance the blue marker to that, and that will extend the needle that far out from the catheter. You have the needle on the left, as you can see, that comes out in a curved fashion, and as I said, the wire that comes out from the needle will go from the distal needle guide wire lumen, and the IVUS transducer is just ahead of this, the needle where it comes out, but as you can see, the needle should be puncturing right about the site of the IVUS transducer. And then at the bottom, you see the connector to the IVUS console. So this is the reentry device for a pure approach. As you can see in A, the wire goes around the vessel itself, into the medial or subadventitial area. The catheter is then inserted over the wire beyond the opening or beyond the distal cap, and the needle is punctured into the lumen. You can see the wire then traversing through the needle into the open vessel, and then that is maintained distally while the catheter is removed. So now for a few case studies. First is case one, 57-year-old white female with a medical history of coronary disease, peripheral disease with claudication on minimal exertion to the right lower extremity, Rutherford class 3, significantly positive ABI, and risk factors of diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and smoking. This is the first angiogram, as you can see. Very severely diseased proximally with a total occlusion of the vessel, and you can see the vessel patency afterwards in Hunter's canal just above the popliteal segment via collaterals. So later laser atherectomy was done, status post pure crossing and re-entry by the Pioneer Plus catheter. As you can see after this, we've had a channel that goes through the vessel. And then post-balloon angioplasty. And the final results show very good patent lumen, good size, minimal dissections without any flow limitation, and certainly excellent flow down below the knee. 3 months after the procedure, patient was still without claudication, had plus two pulses in the posterior tibial vessel, and patient actually presented with new symptoms of numbness and paresthesias from the mid-thigh to behind the right knee. As you can see on here in the angiogram, what happens is from pure approach and the and having to come back in, we can get an aneurysmal development. This is why we feel it's so important to actually stay within the vessel rather than go into the subadventitial space, because the deeper you go, certainly the risk of that is there. By IVUS, you can see the collaterals. You can see the vessel on the top of the screen, collaterals being compromised coming into it on both sides. These are the distal references, where you can see the distal reference and the proximal reference. And you can see the pseudoaneurysm as the true vessel is up on top, and the aneurysm there was at 6 o'clock. So ultimately, two 7x50 millimeter covered stents were placed to the mid SFA of the right lower extremity, as you can see, covering this with very good results. So some tips and tricks of using the Pioneer catheter. I think you need to pay attention to the CTO on the way to the reentry site and look for hematomas and evaluate for axial orientation. So you need to see exactly how deep the subadventitial space goes. As this case, we did not do that, but you could tell that this was a very deep orientation, as it was from the post, where the vessel was significantly away from the actual lumen that was created. You must remember that the imaging element is distal to the needle. Line up the element at the spot where the needle has the best chance to penetrate the plaque. The needle is distal to the element, and the wire may not come out purely at 12 o'clock, so you may have to adjust. You have to really look on the screen to see where that needle, that white element that's coming out. The needle is 24 gauge, and sometimes it's hard to penetrate severe calcium. You may have to go up and down or to try to find a spot where you can penetrate the calcium, and sometimes this will add, you can add 2 millimeters to the needle depth as well, too, to give a more forceful puncture. The other thing to remember is if your imaging element is directly behind the calcium, you may not see the re-entered wire, and so angiography will be helpful on that. What to do if a Pioneer does not re-enter based on our experience? Well, in patients with severe diffuse calcium, you may have to do another approach such as popliteal or tibial or pedal approach. And a reattempt through the proximal cap is another alternative. Try to start another line that you come down through the vessel, and maybe try a central crossing catheter as an added benefit. What to do if you experience some technical difficulties based on our experience? Well, it's certainly not uncommon. We see this where the imaging element will fail when compounded with multiple attempts. A lot of this is damage to the crystal distally, as well as the potential wrapping of the cord around the device as you rotate it. And this is what we see, corkscrewing of the catheter. And when this happens, the connection to the PIM will fail if over-rotated, and you will get image loss. What are the benefits? Certainly cost savings, I think, are significant. You get predictable results in case times. It certainly lowers case times as it improves crossing times. You have lower complication rates, such as what we've seen here. with the subadventitial crossing causing an aneurysm. Decrease use of stents by limiting the treatment lengths. And certainly if you do need to stent, certainly limiting the aspect where you have to go into distal segments such as popliteal. And improve patient comfort due to less time on the table, less analgesics needed, and improved atherectomy by avoiding adventitial cuts, which certainly can be painful, which we see with virtually almost all atherectomy catheters when the catheter becomes subadventitial.